Hello, my name is Gabor Kiss, and in this video I will talk about Banner regressions. In the first part I will talk about the theoretical considerations, how can we imagine pooled, fixed effect, random effect, and dynamic and Hackett Banner regression models, and then in the second part of the video I will talk about practical considerations, so how can we deal with actual data in Prattle and in eViews. So, when we are thinking about panel data structure, it looks like this, that we have the different variables, so the first variable epsilon, then x1, x2, and it goes on in time, like a time series, but it's stacked. So we can see that at the beginning we are using for country 1, let's say we are using country wise data set. So, time series are going down for the first country. Then, if we are running out of the first country, then we can go to the second country and we start the time series again. So, we need a time and an ID column as well to represent that how this thing looks like. Then, if we are thinking about panel data, then we can think about a simple OLS regression, so it's a pooled OLS. It considers nothing at all. It says that there are no cross-sectional, individual, or time-specific effects. It looks like as an ordinary OLS, so we have the epsilon variable here, and we would like to describe the epsilon variable by the different x variables here on the right side of the equation. However, what is happening when we have cross-sectional specific effects? So we can say that, okay, but x variable correlates with an unobserved u variable. So in this case we have to take into consideration it still fluctuates randomly. And it's not changing in time, so it's time independent, but it relates to one country, for example. It depends, for example, there is a specific U for Germany, there is a specific U for France, and so on. But it's not time dependent. And the second thing, when we are saying that, okay, but maybe more variables, I'm time variant, and different from each other. Then actually we can say that, okay, let's move this u to here, to the ordinary error term, and in this case they can live happy with each other. But how can we decide that which model fits better? So in this case, when we are running the model selection, first of all we have to think about the Lagrange multiplier test. In this case, if it's bigger than 0.05, then the pooled OLS can be used. If it's smaller than 0.05, then the random effect model can be preferred. Or we can use the Chow test. So in this case, when it's lower than 0.05, then actually Chow test prefers fixed effect model. Or otherwise it will be pooled OLS. On the other hand, in many cases, people don't care about pooled OLS. So they are saying that, okay, let's choose one of them, so one maybe fixed effect or random effect model will be preferred, and in this case we are just selecting with the Hausmann test. In this case, when the Hausmann test, the p-value of the Hausmann test is bigger than 0.05, then we will select random effect models. Otherwise, if it's lower, then the fixed effect model will be preferred. So let's continue. Because in many cases we can say that we have short time sets. So in this case it will be hard to collect enough legs to deal with autocorrelation of the residuals. And in this case dynamic panel regression can be useful for us, because It says that actually the dataset has tendency towards autocorrelation, but it has been constructed this way. So in this case, we have to look for the following output, that AR1P should be lower than 0.05 because it makes this setup reasonable, and AR2 should be bigger than 0.05. And in this case, it means that with the adding of this lag, we were able to get rid of the autocorrelation, and also the Zargon test should be above 0.05, because in this case we were able to avoid over-identification, so we are not using more than enough variables for the equation. Other solution is about selection. So in many cases we can say that, okay, some countries were able to get some aid, for example, or they were supported by loans from the IMF. And they get the money, they have different characteristics like GDP and so on. But also at the same time there is the selection issues, because maybe some countries were not able to get any kind of money because they don't need that. So to support this underlying selection mechanism, actually we can have this secondary equation, which is we start with a dummy variable. So it says that the country was selected or not, so it's 0, 1. And then actually we can say that, okay, but if it's 1, then what determines this status? So it's kind of a combination of the binary probit logit regressions and the usual forms of regressions, but it's a nice thing. In this case, we have to look for the lambda parameter. So it says that actually the error terms of both equations are independent and normally distributed, and until they are not correlated, then the lambda parameter will be significant. So that's why we have to look for significant lambda, otherwise it not works. Okay, so if you are interested in these topics, I can recommend you 204 papers, because in the left hand we were working with traditional funnel regressions, and on the left right hand article we were working with Heckman selection model to describe contingence among markets. Okay, and then let's see the data. So the data will be about EU country or European countries, and these countries will have a share in the trade. So actually we have the following data here. So what is the difference in exporting goods to the EU? So overall European export and the GDP differential. And after that we are looking for, we would like to explain that how these variables, that countries are big and countries are exporting a lot, can determine that some countries have huge orientation towards the EU and some not this relationship. So we are expecting that small member states where this GDP differential is big, and also the export differential will be also big, will have also big share, because they are mostly doing their trade with the European Union. And also there are some dummy variables to represent recessions, to represent Eurozone membership, and to represent EU member state relationship. And you can see here that, yeah, for first country we have 16 data, which is not so much, because 20 would be nice. So that's why we will face troubles soon. Also there is second country, and actually there are many countries, so 18 countries are represented here, And also the dummy variables are representing that the first years they were not part of the U. Okay, so I use logarithms, but let's start with Gretel. That actually we would like to use the input time series interpretation, of course. Panel forward, use index variable forward, we can see country time, forward, apply, and then because it's nice to have stationary data in regressions, it's highly mandatory, so let's take the differences because in this case we can be sure that it will support us. So then let's see the model, fixed random effect models. So we are looking for the U share and we are looking for the size and also the dummies set as default, and let's hope it works. Actually, Durbin Watson is excellent here, so we can say that nice. Let's collect this output. And with data, text to rows, no, it's not. Now we have fancy output. And we are looking for the Durbin Watson. That Durbin Watson is okay, so it's green. Also, we can see that these variables were significant. So let's say that they are also green. Actually, I was hoping that the GDP will be significant, so big countries tend to trade more, but it's not. But can we say that it's useful? So now we can say that, okay, but okay, Excel starts to become too okay, still we have to convert these things to the, from decimal points to commas because of reasons. And actually, here we can say that it's nice, it's still significant. But actually, what can we say about Hausmann test? Because it selects as one of the model, and in this case, because it's smaller than 0.05, so it says that we have to use the fixed effect model. So we can say that this one is the cool one. And in this case, we were able to say that, okay, we had no problem or no issues with the autocorrelation, but still, let's see that what can happen if we are saying that, okay, let's use dynamic panel model. I'll just hit okay. Actually, we can see a thing here. So copy, comma separated, period, and then convert it. Visual way, and actually we can stop here because Zargon test says that no, we are using too much variable, so it's not significant. So so that's why we have to say that let's get rid of the export. No, it's still rubbish. It would be nice, but it's rubbish. Okay, so let's say that let's get rid of the dummy. No, it's still not. Recession. No, it's still not. It was all membership. So, actually, we were able to get rid of everything, but Zargon test says that no, we can't do this. Still, we can say that okay, but what is happening when we get rid of the GDP? And it's still useless. So, in many cases, we can say that yeah, but let's use two-step regression, and in this case, it fulfills the Zargon test criteria. So after that, we can have a happy and well-functioning model. And again, so in this case, Zargon test has been fulfilled. And actually, we were able to see that, yeah, if someone is exporting, so they have smaller share from the overall export in Europe, actually, it will increase their orientation towards the EU in trade, but not the GDP, which is funny. Even if we are able to say that, let's get rid of this. Yeah, in this case, GDP will answer the question. And also, we have to talk about that we need this structure as well. So this should be smaller than 0.05. This should be bigger than 0.05. So we can accept this kind of criteria as well. Okay, then we have one thing to do, one last thing in panel. And this is limited dependent variable, and hack it. So right now, let's say that selection variable will be dummy. Yep, sorry, it's not tedious. And first of all, we have to say that are they in the Eurozone? They should be integrated more. Okay, and the selection process will be so let's say we are using GDP, and here we are using, we need to use something, so that's why we will use this export share, and also we are adding recession. So in this case, we are saying that small countries are more welcomely attending, warmly attending in the Eurozone because they are small, and then they will. That's why they will export. They will have higher export share on the EU market. Let's see that. Can we have any kind of meaningful result here? And actually, we don't. So we can see that now it is highly nonsense. Actually, we have another chance. So this two-step equation actually calculated it a different way, but yeah, it's still nonsense. So. Doesn't matter for us. Okay, so that was the Gretel, and then let's see everything in EBUs. And here we can say that input next, next, next. We have to play this because here we have to save this structure. Dated panel, and the ID will be country. And date, time. It's funny that the free Gretel was able to recognize everything, but at the same time, we have to teach EBUs to do their job. And still, we have to calculate the differential, so object generate series. I prepared this already. So we are taking the difference of the data and we are generating new variables with this. Actually, this is the differential, so the okay, then we have to do this variable wise. Okay, now we have all of them happily here, and then we actually, right now the use runs completely in panel regression mode, so we don't have to turn on anything. It knows that it's a panel data, so it provides us only models available in panel structure. So, let's see that you share from X, we need a constant, and also we need the ln export differential and the ln GDP differential, and also we have to add the dummy EU member states for EU membership and dummy recession, because recessions have to be done. And actually first will be the old OLS. So if we are doing nothing here, we are saying that none, then we are executing this, then we can see that yeah, the Urbi Watson is still perfect as it was in the Gretel. And after that, we can see that, but let's see the different tests. So, we can have Lagrange multiplier test to see that how cross dependency is happening. Yep, sorry, this is not the right. So let's see Peaks defect. Okay, Dolby Watson increased a bit, but still, we can accept this. Everything is similar. What we were able to see before, and also Now we have the show test, which is nice. And then we can, so we don't need to use the pool. We can select the random. Kirby Watson is still okay. And this GDP is still utterly useless. And this one is still significant. So actually we have parallel results with them. With the Gretel, because it says that we have to use fixed effect models. Okay, then instead of using the fixed effect, random effect, and pooled OLS models, then let's see the dynamic. I don't want to use dynamic because we can do this, but actually it's way faster in Gretel. That's my experience. So let's use the head. So in this case we are saying that easy. We have to exclude maybe this, but we will see that it's able to perform or not. Then we are taking that the small ones. Are here. And I think that was all. But I have to turn on and then we can see that what kind of error message do we have. Yep. And membership has to be taken away. And now we can see that what is happening. Poor row is not. Oh, it's significant. So we don't have lambda variable, we have row, but actually it should be significant, so we can say that noise. And actually even this says that they are joining because they are small, but that's all what we can see here. Okay, so that was all for this video. So see you next time. Bye bye.